Well, good morning, everybody. How are we doing? Woo! We excited about today?
Woo! So excited.
I did not eat breakfast because I wanted to eat all of your foods. So I'm going last, so there will be no leftovers. So this morning, we're wrapping up our series, He's Still Got the Whole World in His Hands. We're landing the plane, we're bringing it in for a closing. We got one more big topic that I want to talk about. But this morning, I want to start off by teaching you guys a Bible verse. Y'all want to learn a Bible verse with me? Okay. So if you would please read this with me out loud. They're going to put it up here on the screen. That's definitely not the background that's supposed to be with it, because it's going to be really hard for them to read that. There we go. All right, y'all ready? Okay, ready? Psalms 33:22. May your unfailing love be with us, Lord, even as we put our hope in you. One more time. May your unfailing love be with us, Lord, even as we put our hope in you. All right, now take it off the screen. We're going to do it without the screen. Y'all ready? Ready? May your unfailing love be with us, Lord, even as we put our hope in you. All right? Some of y'all mumbled that. That's okay. I get it. Y'all didn't. It's real quick. We got to, you know. So anyways. So today, I want to talk about one of the most difficult tensions that we have to manage in our life, and it's this. How do we remain hopeful in a hopelessly broken world? All right? And if you've ever had something, what a question. Every one of us will wrestle with this at some point, right? And if you've ever had something you place your hope in and it comes crashing down around you, you know, like your marriage or your career or your wealth, your health, your engagements, right? Your academics, your athletics, whatever it might be, whatever you had your hope in and you've ever thought, like, why even try? What's the use? What's the point? Then you understand the dilemma of this question, how to remain hopeful in a hopelessly broken world. You've managed that tension of how do you maintain that hope in which seems like to be this hopelessly broken world that just spirals out of control. And if you found yourself managing if you haven't found yourself managing this tension yet, it's coming. The world's broken. John, I thought the title of your message was hope. We're getting there, okay? We got to start off where we can get all on that same page, right? So first, a few introductory thoughts on hope, okay? Webster defines hope as to want something to happen or be true and think that it could happen or be true. That's the Webster definition of hope. Now, the biblical definition is a little bit different, okay? The biblical definition is the expectations of the fulfillment of God's promises. A little bit different, right? Now, the person or thing in which you place your confidence as it relates to your future, that, like, hopelessness is really, it's a feeling that comes with knowing that that person or that thing in which you've placed your hope will not or cannot come through. That's when hopelessness happens. When whatever you have your hope in fails, you become hopeless, right? From the day you were born, we've all placed our hope in something. As kids, usually it's who? Our parents. Wow, some of us have some real issues there, right? Because our hope was crushed. At some point, though, that hope shifts, and when our parents prove to be unreliable, or we choose something else to put our hope in, right? Because hope ends up being like this. A ladder leaned up against a wall. We trust it to support our dreams. Our security and our future. This is something we never think about until what? The wall disappears. And then it's like air. And when it begins to evaporate, we grasp for hope like we grasp for air when it starts to dissipate. And all of a sudden, we feel hopeless. We feel helpless, and we feel powerless. And the older we get, the more prone we are to lean our ladders against people and things that promise financial and emotional security. And here's why it always is these two areas. They're the leading causes. These two things are the leading cause of suicide in the United States today. It is the center on the overwhelming sense of hopelessness is relationships and finances. Right? That's a statistic nobody wants to hear on this Sunday morning, right? Friendsgiving, what are you talking about? You're welcome. Right? But throughout the pages of history, we are told to put our hope in God. The only way to maintain hope in a broken world is to place our hope in the right thing, and that is God. But we are hesitant in this nation particularly to do that because we are convinced our world isn't that broken. We believe that we can lead ourselves through exercise and through drugs and through surgeries and through education to a place where we are untouchable. And that is where we lean our ladders, and then we go to work to ensure that that ladder stays leaned up against that wall. But they don't. Our ladders don't stay there. They don't, because our world is broken. And it's more broken than we can even begin to imagine. Now, the Bible addresses this head on in many, 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 many places. But I think the clearest place that it really addresses this head on is in Romans chapter 8. So if you have your Bible, you can go ahead and open it. We're going to be in Romans chapter 8. We're going to pick it up in around verse 20. That's where we're going to start off, okay? So you can go ahead, open your Bible, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, four gospel accounts of Jesus, Acts of the Apostles, Romans. Right after Acts is Romans, okay? So that's where we're going to be looking at today, where Paul gives us some valuable insight. Now, this was written to Roman Christians under Emperor Nero. We talked about him a couple of weeks ago, but just a quick fact about Nero. In 64 AD, there was a fire that swept through most of Rome that started at Circus Maximus, which was Nero's circus, right? And guess who Nero blamed? Christians. Okay? I'm going to read you an excerpt from Tacitus, I think that's how you pronounce his name. I don't know. He's a Roman historian, politician, right? He said this. This is out of a letter, a historic document that they found and that they've translated. This is what it says. It says, Nero fashioned the guilt and inflicted the most exquisite tortures on a class hated for their abominations called Christians by the populace. Mockery of every sort was added to their deaths. Covered with the skins of beasts, they were torn by dogs and perished. Or they were nailed to crosses. They were doomed to flames and burnt to serve as nightly illumination when daylight had expired. It's coming. I just want to remind you the person that Paul has to stand trial before. That's who's writing this letter that we're going to look at today. Right? That's crazy. Like, you guys can't even begin. So anyways, we're going to be in Romans chapter 8. Like I said, if you got your Bibles, you can turn there. If you got the Bible app, you can open the Bible app. All the verses are in there. You can read along with us there. It also has the link to the giving for Dana's mission trip. It's on there as well. So y'all can go on there, click on it. It'll open up and send you to the place to give to the mission trip if you so choose. Okay. So Romans chapter 8, Paul explains where our hope should be. Okay. And this will be no surprise, but more importantly for our discussion, Paul explains that this is so important for our discussion, that Paul explains that this is so important, the uselessness of any of us to lean our ladder against our ability to control or predict the future. It's useless, okay? To lean our ladder against anything to do with the temporary nature of this world. And in making this case, it's a little bit negative, I gotta warn you. But at the end, he comes back around and he says, this is why it's so important for you and for me to begin to put our hope in the Lord. Our hope in the Lord. Our hope in God. So here's what we're going to do. We're going to pick it up in verse 20. I'm going to tell you what verse 20 means before I let you look at it. And if you think, John, that's confusing, or I think you skipped some parts, I'm going to skip through some of these verses. I only have 30 to 40 minutes, okay? This, like, I could teach this section of scripture probably for like 2 hours. I got 30 to 40 minutes, okay? Y'all are going to get hungry because you're going to start smelling food, and then I'm going to get hungry because I'm smelling food, and okay, we got to get going. Anyways, and if you think, John, that's really confusing, you skip some parts. I am skipping through the scripture, and I'm telling you that up front. And if you get frustrated or mad at me because of this, good. Go home. I dare you to get your Bible out and read it for yourself. That's always a win, right? Even if it's to prove your pastor wrong, just go ahead and do it. In fact, tomorrow morning, for those of you who read the Bible in the morning or you've been thinking that you ought to do that, right? Start with Romans 8:20 and read it back through these verses on your own and fill in the gaps where I skipped some verses, because this is so rich. And I mean, it's so relevant to where we are today as the culture that we're in, the world that we're living in, right? I lost my spot. Thank you. Okay, so here we're at, Romans chapter 8, okay? Verse 20, and he says, here's the deal. So he goes back to, and he draws from the event of the book of Genesis, and typically refers to the fall of man. It's the story about where sin, or when sin, entered the world, right? And now my other screen is going crazy. This typically fall of man, and the story is about when sin enters the world. Now, you may not believe in sin, that's fine, but you do know bad things happen in the world, so together, we're together on that, right? We all agree bad things happen to good people in this world. Happens all the time. The worst thing in the world happened to the best person ever. Right? So you know bad things happen. And when you think about sin, we usually think about an incident. Like, that was sinful. Or if you're in a business, you think, like, it's just, I'm so flustered all of a sudden. All right, so here we go. Let's slow down. Slow down, okay? Right? We think that sin is usually an incident. Like, that was sinful. And if you're in my business, it's funny. Often people say, John, do you think such and such is a sin? Do you think this is a sin? And basically what they're saying is it okay if I do this? Well, they don't actually say that, but that's what they mean, right? Do you think that this is a sin? Because we think of sin as something you do because it's an incident. We don't think of it as a lifestyle or something that we tend to believe. The Bible views sin as a disease that's toxic and fatal. And the Bible teaches that when sin entered the world, it entered the world as a fatal disease that impacted everything. Relationships, creation, the relationship between people and the Creator, the animal kingdom, the weather, it affected everything. that everything in the world was impacted by sin. It's a disease that has infiltrated the entire creation, and that it was fatal, which means, according to Genesis, everything that lives eventually what? Dies. Have you noticed that? Everything living eventually dies. We say stuff like, well, that's just the circle of life. Yeah, I saw that movie too, The Lion King. Okay? They figured out the whole thing, right? That's one view. But Genesis, the scripture teaches, Jesus affirmed, and Paul talks about the reason everything in the world dies is because sin has polluted and corrupted everything. Everything. That is the basis for his argument that this is always a bad decision to put our hope in things that pertain to this world. Okay? That's what he's getting ready to talk about. Now let's read the verse, and we're going to jump through these verses, okay? Beginning in verse 20, he says this: "For the creation was subject to frustration." How many of you have ever been frustrated? There it is. You were subject to frustration. Whenever you're frustrated, it's because of sin. Did you know that? The reason your experiences in this world can be called so frustrating. Why won't those kids? Why won't my mom? Why won't my dad? Why won't my boss? Why can't people see the world the way I see it? Why won't people give me a chance? Why won't she or he call me back? I'm so frustrated. Paul says, welcome to the world that God, because sin entered the world, God has made the decision. And I'm telling you, if you'll remember this, it'll help you understand your experiences in life a little bit better. God has allowed sin to run its course. When sin entered the world, God said, I'm going to let that go like a wave. It's going to touch everything. It's going to impact everything. And it's going to corrupt everything. If you don't believe me, look at the politics in America. It's rampant. Paul says that creation was subject to frustrations, that sin is going to run its course in the world. And in the middle of verse 20, he says, for creation was subject to frustration in hope, right? That's our word that we're looking for, hope. We're talking about hope, that the creation itself will be, being future tense, liberated from its, look at this phrase, bondage of decay. It means that everything in this world is decaying. And you know that to be the case. When you reach a certain age, every time you look in the mirror, you go, oh. And that's the bondage of decay. That's what it is. You go, something is wrong with me. Nope, nope, nope. That's the bondage of decay. And it's kind of funny. It's not very encouraging, but this is the case he's building right now. Everything is decaying, including your relationships, including your wealth. Ultimately, everything has a ring, and that ring smells of decay. Encouraging, John. Thanks for bringing the word. Right? Right. Now, this is amazing. On February 21st, 2018, do you know what happened? Billy Graham died. Cheater! Wow. I was going to give you mad props, but you read it right off the screen in front of you. It's like, what? What? Billy Graham? Yeah. He can't die. Look at all the good he did. Look as much as he did in this world. Do you know what happened to his body? his holy, amazing, pure, and awesome body that housed this amazing brain and compassion for lost people, do you know what happened to it? It died and is decaying. If Billy Graham can't beat the odds, if he can't find a way around, if he couldn't win, if he couldn't talk God out of it, if he couldn't beat the system, I've got some bad news for you, and I got some bad news for me. Okay, Billy Graham's not your person. Pick the most famous person that you can think of that is a Christian that believes in God. Mother Teresa? 1997, Mother Teresa died. Look at all the good she did in the world. They should have got a pass. They've been so good. They've accomplished so much good. The world was better because they were born. And God says, and Paul says, and you know from your experiences, you know what? We live in a world that is in bondage, in the bondage of decay. You know that. You know that to be true. God is going, God is letting sin run its course, and it touches everything, the good, the bad, the ugly. It touches everything. And there aren't many that live happily ever after. Did you know that? Disney got it wrong. It doesn't happen like that. Because when sin entered the world, it messed up every single thing. It touches everything. We live in a world of decay. I know what you're thinking. I hope this is going to get happier. We're going to get there. But I gotta get us to understand what we're living in. Because there is hope. But here's the thing. The reason we lean our ladder up against the wrong wall is because we don't really believe there is hope. We believe we can beat the odds. We believe that we can be careful enough. We can be slick enough. We can be cool enough. After all, we've got it all figured out. And Paul is saying, before I get to the good news, you've got to really embrace the bad news. That this is no, you're not that good. No, you're not that cool. No, there's no way of beating the odds. And he's writing all of this while in home arrest during the reign of Emperor Nero. The creation in which all of us and everything is in the bondage of decay. Yes, we have happy birthdays, and yes, we have great vacations. Drew, I hope you and your family had a blast on your vacation. We're glad you're back, right? Okay? Yes, your engagement is awesome, and your honeymoon was great, and your family is happy, maybe, okay? I don't know. And you had the first kid, and maybe the fourth kid, it's on the way, I don't know. There's this some mountaintop experiences, and I love that worship song this morning, and yeah, it was fun. And there is joy, but the movement, the momentum, the ultimate thing is towards sin and towards decay, and we are in bondage to that kind of frustration. Verse 22, he goes on, and I'm not going to read this one to you. Verse 22 and 23, he says that the tension creates in us a longing for something better. This tension creates in us the thought that there's got to be more. Y'all get that. The tension creates in us the desire to look beyond our lives and beyond this life. To say that there's a world where there is a happily ever after. In a world where relationships stay good. In a world where people get along. And it forces us to look outside of ourselves and outside of our life. In verse 24, I'm going to read this one. He says, for in this hope, again, here's our word, this hope that there's more to this life than this life, this hope that one day, as he referred to earlier, that we wouldn't always be in the bondage of decay. For in this hope, we were what? Saved. That when you became a Christian, when you became linked to a bigger, better story, which was much with a much better ending. But guess what? That story goes way beyond this life. That hope we're saved to, then in verse 25, this is the kind of the transition point to where we go to the happy stage, okay? This is the transition point of his argument. He says in verse 25, but if we hope for what we do not have yet, we wait for it. How? Patiently. That's not a world that runs rampant in America, ever. You can order something from Google while I'm preaching and have it at your home by the time you get home. Do you know what that means? That means we do not give up hope, but our hope is not in this world. Our hope can't be in this life because eventually that hope is always in some way, shape, or form disappointed because we live in a world that is in the bondage of decay that's full of frustration. He says, as believers, you have something to look forward to. As believers, you have something to wait for patiently. Then in verse 26 through 30, I'm going to skip these. In verse 26 through 30, he says, God understands your frustration and God understands your disappointment and God understands that your ladder falls every once in a while and God understands that you sense you are so hurt and so disappointed sometimes that you just kind of groan on the inside. And that he says that God understands that his spirit prays for you. Can you believe that? God's spirit prays for you. And prays for you and prays for me with words that can't even be uttered, with groanings. And if you have ever been in one of those pits of despair, even if you've ever hit rock bottom in the terms of hopelessness, you know what it's like to get on your face or to lay in your bed or lay on the floor and just moan. There's nothing that can be done. And God says, I understand that. I understand the pointlessness to this world seems to offer something. I understand that this sense of isolation, I understand all of that. And then he turns the corner and he skips down to verse 31. He says, what then shall we say in response to these things? Check this out. Paul, in prison, facing this Emperor Nero, says, if God can be is for us, who can be against us? If God is for us, who can be against us? What do you mean if God is for us? Verse 32. He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for who? All. How will he not also, along with him, graciously give all things? The point is that God became the focus of your hope. And as you center your expectations in the love of your heavenly Father, he says that there will be hope that does not disappoint. Skipping down to verse 28, big ending. If there was a soundtrack with music, this is where the music would build big, big, big time right now. Right? Check this out. For I am convinced, he said. Now this is Paul again, who has been stoned with stones, not like the other stoned. He's been in prison. He is in prison writing this. He's been left for dead. He's been shipwrecked 3 times. He's been beaten. I mean, this is the guy that has experienced the worst that the first century had to offer Christians. He said, I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future. Any power, neither height or depth, nor nothing else which you can fill in the blank, neither divorce, abandonment, isolation, job loss. What do I do because I'm retired? Nothing else in this world, nor anything else and all creation will be able to separate us from what? What's the word here? From the love of who? God in Christ Jesus, our Lord. You know what he's saying here? He's saying, look, you want to put your hope in something secure? You want to put your hope in something that won't disappoint? You want to put your hope in something that can go the distance? Something that you can go to every time you feel hopeless? He says, you need to move your ladder off that wall of whatever you got it on and lean it on to God's love. And I don't care how educated you are, or and I don't care how educated your family might think you are. I mean, that's great, and we'll talk about that. But if you want hope that remains hopeful, if you want to maintain hope in a hopelessly broken world, he says you've got to move your ladder and lean it against your heavenly Father, for only there will you find enduring hope in a world that is hopelessly broken. Now, what does that mean in the meantime? It means, yes, you do your best. It means that you live out, if I can say it this way, you live out kingdom values in this world where there aren't a lot of happily ever afters, where there's not necessarily a lot of happy endings. I mean, that you love like crazy. I mean, literally, that's what Jesus told us, to love as I have loved. He loved you crazy enough to die on a cross for you. You love like crazy because when you don't get loved, even when you don't get loved back, you know why you love like crazy when you don't get loved back? So you don't lose hope. Because your hope wasn't in there to begin with. It means you serve like crazy. You know why you serve like crazy even when you don't get served back? So you don't lose hope because your hope wasn't in the fact that you're supposed to get served. You want to know why you forgive like crazy? Guess what? Same thing. Even when people don't forgive you back or you don't get the benefit of forgiveness, it's so you don't lose hope because you never planned on getting the forgiveness in the first place. Do you plan? Of course you plan. Do you have ambition? Yes, you have ambitions. Do you leverage your skills and your talents? Yes, of course you leverage your skills and your talents. But do you build these things? Do you pursue progress? Do you save? Do you love? Do you engage culture? Do you engage the world? Yes. Yes, you do all of that. Do you place your hope in your hard work? Do you place your hope in the benefit of your ambitions or your disciplines? Do you place your hope in your education? Do you place your hope in those things? Paul says no. Jesus says no. I'm sure Billy Graham says no. Your mama probably says no. Your grandmama says no. We hold it with an open hand and say, this stuff that I live with is temporary, but your love is eternal. Because when we loosen our grip from around our plans, our treasures, and our ambitions, this crazy thing happens. Our plans, our treasures, and our ambitions loosen their grip from around our hearts. When we loosen our grips from around our plans, our treasures, and our ambitions, our plans, treasures and ambitions, loosen their grip from around our hearts. And we have this amazing opportunity to take our ladder and move it to the wall that is secure and will never fail us, which is God's love. Now, we are discovering where our hope is leaning, right? Is it leaning on the wall of your finances? Is it leaning on the wall of your job? Is it leaning on the wall of your relationships? Or is it leaning on God's love? Because you either move it or you're going to lose your hope. What or whom determines your hope? Your ability to maintain this hope in this world. What determines that? And you've been invited to lean your hope against God's unending love for you. You know how I know that? I taught it to you in the beginning. May your unfailing love be with us, Lord, even as we put our hope in you. We place our hope in God's love for us. Let's pray. Father, we thank you that even in the craziness that Paul experienced, in a world where every time something went wrong, the polytheistic people thought it was the Christians' fault. And as we saw, every form of torture came upon them. But yet they did not lose hope. Because their hope wasn't in anything of this world or anything in this world, because we live in a world that is decaying. But you are the eternal life. You give us living water. So we thank you and we love you. And we thank you for the fact that this scriptures, these words were documented and made it throughout the history of the world to where we can still see that it doesn't matter, death or life, height or depth, it doesn't matter. Nothing will separate us from the love of God, which is where our hope is this morning. And Holy Spirit, I just ask that you speak to every heart here, to anybody who might have their ladder leaning up against the wrong wall, that you would speak to them and you would show them that their hope is decaying. And when hope is deferred, their heart will be sick. But if we put our hope in the one thing that is everlasting, that is eternal, which is you and your son, Jesus Christ, and what he did on the cross, our hope is for everlasting. And we give you the glory and we give you the honor this morning that even in a world that is hopeless and broken, Father, we have hope that is eternal. And we thank you and we give you the honor this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.